Well, I got a little helpful suggestion during the break that dessert is with two S's because you want to go back for more. So that's a really helpful hint. You always want to go back for more. You don't want to go to the desert, but actually today that's exactly what we're going to be talking about, going intentionally into the desert if we're not in a desert already. And some of you I know are in the desert, so I want to be sensitive to that. But this past Wednesday was Ash Wednesday. Which officially marks the beginning of the Lenten season. And you know, Lent is something that we recognize here at Newbridge and have over the years. And because of its importance in the church calendar, I think that there's an enormous value in observing at least some of the most important moments in the church calendar. Of course, this goes back to the second and third century, hundreds and hundreds, thousands of years, this tradition has been observed. And one of the important benefits, I think, as I see it anyway, is that it forces you and me to get out of the ruts that we tend to get into, both personally and even corporately as a church. You know, we like to live on the mountaintops, don't we? We like to live where the best view is. And I'm not knocking that, but here's what I mean. So often we're pushing towards the mountaintop experiences, the places where we are emotionally and spiritually in a good place. That's kind of where we like to live. We like to live in the place where the battle is already won. Now, I don't want you to misunderstand me this morning. The battle is won in Jesus. He defeated death, right? Theologically and spiritually speaking, the victory has been secured. The cross is spoken. But we need to remember, and this is crucial, we need to remember that we're still in the midst of the battle. I had a pastor tell me one time, you know, I think he might have even said from the platform, you know, I don't like this talk that we're still in the battle. And that's just poor theology. We know the end of the story. We know that Jesus has defeated the grave, sin, and death, but we are still in the midst of the battle. And so we're in this in-between time, this already the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God has come, but not yet in its fullness. And so we like to live in that place where we're on the mountaintop, but we got to recognize that we're in the midst of the battle. Now, as you all well know, the mountaintop is not always the reality of our lives, even our spiritual lives. And while mountaintop experiences are exhilarating, they're not the constant reality. No one stays up on top of the mountain. All of us go through valleys as well. I think of the moment in the Gospels, I mentioned it a few weeks back, where Jesus is with Peter, James, and John, his most trusted disciples, and they go up literally on a mountaintop, and the transfiguration happens. Jesus' faces and clothes are glowing like white, and Peter, in this excitement, in the excitement of the moment, says, "Hey, let's build three shelters so we can stay in this moment. So we can stay right here." We like to be on the mountaintop with Jesus glowing and everything, and we want to stay there. And Jesus kind of puts that to bed real quick. And they come off the mountain. And no doubt for the disciples, and especially Jesus himself, there were deep valleys ahead for them, weren't they? And that's life. I don't mean to be a Debbie Downer this morning, but that's life. We can't live our lives always in this place of mountaintop experiences. Now, as we consider the season of Lent historically, we can trace it, like I said, all the way back to the second or third centuries, where the church has observed the period of approximately 40 days or 46 days, depending on how you count, leading up to Easter. And the season of Lent, or the Lenten season, is the practice really rooted or based in Jesus's desert experience in the Gospels, right after he's baptized, the 40 days that he spent in the wilderness at the start of his ministry. And the idea here is, as a spiritual practice or a discipline, is to spend intentional time in the desert leading up to Holy Week. This is the purpose of the practice, and to do without some things for a time so that you and I can prepare our hearts and our minds and our souls for the death and the resurrection of Jesus. How many of you know that some of the most important life lessons are learned in the desert? Both in a physical sense, but also in a metaphorical sense. The Bible is full of examples of desert experiences, whether people are physically in deserts or not. And I want us to consider some of them for a moment before we dive into our main text. Moses and the people of God spent how many years in the desert? 40 years in the desert, wandering around. Moses was one of the greatest leaders that ever lived, and he grew into his leadership in the desert. It was forged in the desert with people that were complaining and always wanted to go back to Egypt and didn't quite get it, and he had to lead them along in the desert. And don't forget about the first part of his life. His very life as an infant was under threat, and he's scooped up by Pharaoh's daughter. And most of his first 40 years were nondescript, a waiting period. Nothing was really going on in his life. And then you got the story of Elijah the prophet, right, who fled to the desert to escape Queen Jezebel's threats, and he was sustained by God there, right? In the midst of a drought, he himself prophesied about, God shows him where to find water. Not only that, but he sends ravens with food to sustain Elijah. And in the Newer Testament, John the Baptist lived in the desert before beginning his ministry of baptizing others, including Jesus. And many scholars think, and if you come to Israel with me next year, you can see the place in the desert where they think John the Baptist lived, with a community called the Essenes, who lived in the desert, and they were a people who were foregoing worldly pleasures, seeking God alone in the desert. Even the Apostle Paul spent time in the desert. Joseph, most of Joseph's life was a desert, right? He's left for dead by his brothers. He's sold into slavery. He's falsely accused. He spent years locked up in jail. But God would use those years to form him into the strong leader and the godly man that he would become. None of that's possible without those desert experiences. I could go on, David. I mean, there's so many examples of him running away from King Saul, hiding in a cave, avoiding near death. So many of the greatest psalms that we have are David expressing those desert times, right? What a valuable piece of theology there in the Psalms, where we can see David saying, how long will I have to suffer this experience? And there's so many more examples. The point here is that this is a repeated pattern throughout all of the scripture. All of these examples and so many more show us that God uses the desert to form us and to shape us. And so over the course of this series for the next 5 weeks, we're going to spend some time reflecting on the desert experience. And maybe more importantly, focus and glean from the wisdom of the desert experience. And as we start out today, we're going to start with Jesus asking the question, why did he have to go into the desert? And maybe more importantly, what did he learn or gain from his time in the desert. So before we go any further, I want to root this in the testimony of the scripture that I just mentioned, but I've chosen to start a little further back in the story because I think it's important. I think they're very much connected. With Jesus's baptism, right before God, through his Holy Spirit, sends Jesus into the desert. We're in Mark chapter 1 today, starting in verse 9. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from him, from heaven, "You are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." At once, the Spirit sent him into the wilderness, out into the wilderness or the desert, and he was in the wilderness 40 days being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals and angels attended to him. Now, FYI, what Mark... And we see this throughout the Gospels. He's walking out and he's living into the path of the first Adam, like Adam and Eve, in every respect, so that he could be the second Adam. The Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 15 mentions this idea of the first Adam and the second Adam, that the first Adam failed all the tests. And yet Jesus, as the second Adam, was an acceptable sacrifice for the sin of the world. For as in Adam we all die, so in Christ we are made alive, Paul says. And so the desert experience, I think, is no different than the baptism, in that Jesus is walking the way of human beings, right? Remember, he's fully human. We often like to think of him as only deity, but he was fully human. He felt pain. He sweat when it was hot out. He got tired. He was hungry. He was fully human. And remember, the scripture says repeatedly that Jesus did not do anything that the Father did not lead him to do. He's following the lead of the Father. And in this case, the Spirit of God, like we said last week, we need the Spirit of God to show us how to live and which way to go. Now, maybe this is just me, but I just naturally think that for Jesus, after he's 30 years old at this point, at his baptism, after 30 years of mostly waiting to get started, we know in the scripture that when he was 12 years old, he was kind of teaching and in the temple, and people are like, whoa, this kid's really smart. Right? But other than that, we don't really know much about his first 30 years. And so for waiting 30 years, now this is the moment. You would think he's baptized, he's anointed by the Holy Spirit for ministry, and you would think that he would just start healing people and turning water into wine and preaching and teaching and all of the things that we know him for in the Gospels. All the things. And yet that's not what happens. He's anointed into ministry, and the Holy Spirit sends him into the desert. Yeah. What's going on there? It pushes me to ask why. Why did the Spirit lead him straight into the desert? And I think that there's something significant that we can miss if we don't take time to contemplate the why here. Now, Mark here in his gospel doesn't detail the three temptations. We talked about that a few weeks ago, and I want to summarize that for you and recap if you were not here in case you missed it. The temptations have all to do with what are common to human beings, hunger and power and influence, really to take the position of God. The first sin that Adam and Eve really committed in the Garden of Eden was to try to be like God. That was Satan's temptation to them. And so Jesus is tempted with turning stones into bread, right? The devil is going after his stomach, saying, hey, listen, after fasting for 40 days, you are hungry and you have the power to turn this stone into bread and satisfy your hunger. And Jesus says, no, I'm not going to misuse my divine power for personal comfort. I'm on a mission here. And that mission is to embrace my humanity. The Lord God took on flesh and dwelt among us for a reason. And so if you're pretending to, you know, if Jesus pretended to only be a deity and never actually lived into and stepped into his human self, guess what? He would not be the sacrifice that you and I needed on the cross for our sin. The next temptation, the kingdoms of the world, the devil took Jesus to a high place and he showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he offered all this to Jesus if he would just bow down and worship him. And this is the temptation, obviously, of the allure of power and earthly dominion, all trying to detour Jesus from his mission by offering this immediate authority without the path of suffering and sacrifice. And Jesus, again, quotes the word of God and said, no, we're not playing that game. And finally, he takes Jesus to the pinnacle of the temple and tries to provoke Jesus to break his faithfulness of God in a reckless way. And really, the testing of God. And Jesus says, no, don't test the Lord your God. Now, all of these temptations are the same, are very similar, I think. In fact, I think they're essentially the same as Adam and Eve faced in the garden. And as we know, they failed the test. The devil's saying, he says to them, you know, God is holding out on you. Wouldn't you like to be like God yourself, right? Ultimately, don't take of this fruit, God says, because you don't want to know, you don't want to have the knowledge of good and evil. And the devil tempts them and says, don't you want to be like God? God is holding out on you. Don't you want to be in charge? And this is what's so powerful about the gospel is that Jesus was actually God, right? He was there in the beginning. Nothing was made that has been made that hadn't been made through him. And yet, again, he embraces the fact that this is the mystery of the incarnation, is that God became flesh. And so he doesn't do any of those things that the enemy tempts him with in the desert, even though he had the power to do so. I remind you, I want to read from you the scripture, Philippians 2. This is what Jesus is doing. The Apostle Paul says, Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but he made himself nothing. Did he have the power to turn those stones into bread? Absolutely. But that's not how he was going to accomplish his mission. He made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. And because of that, Paul writes, therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. You see, the desert ultimately, I believe, brings us to the place where God can transform us and work in and through us for his purposes. We lay ourselves down so that we can be lifted up. Not in our own strength, but in his. And so I want to say to you again, some of the most important life lessons are learned in the desert. You might be saying, what could Jesus possibly have had to have learned? Again, he was God, right? But he was also human. I said yesterday at the dinner table, sometimes I give them a synopsis of where I'm going on Sunday morning. Sometimes it's the last minute bouncing off of things to my theological crew there, whether it's my wife or my father-in-law or my mother-in-law or even my daughter. She has got a lot of opinions and done a lot of reading. I said, it almost feels like sacrilegious to say that Jesus learned anything. Right? It just doesn't feel like, did he really have to learn anything? But clearly he did. And the scripture, Luke says that Jesus grew in wisdom and in stature, that he grew in knowledge and understanding and in favor with God and man. And this just points to the importance of the fact that he was human as well. And just to emphasize the necessity of God's of Jesus' humanity, especially as he faced those temptations, the writer of Hebrews in chapter 4 says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weakness, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin." That is an amazing gift. See, the reason I believe that Jesus was sent into the desert at the beginning of his earthly ministry is that it establishes a pattern and a model for us that Jesus was going to have to empty himself of everything. He would have to empty himself of himself, of all of the human things that he faced, the temptations. And he wasn't just modeling for us a path to God. He had to empty himself so that by the time he got to the cross, God could accomplish through him the restoration of all of humanity. I couldn't help but think of the third verse of the timeless hymn, "And Can It Be?" by Charles Wesley. It starts, "He left his Father's throne above, so free, so infinite his grace, emptied himself of all but love, and bled for Adam's helpless race. 'Tis mercy all immense and free, for, oh my God, it found out me." See, I think that as Jesus shows us the process of emptying himself here, at one of the most important lessons in the beginning of his ministry is that we learn these things in the desert. And we learn that we can't make it on our own, that we need to be fully dependent upon God himself to sustain us, and not just to sustain us, but to give us the victory in the face of trials and temptations. Even Jesus needed to rely on the Father and the Spirit. That's why he received the Spirit at baptism. He needed that anointing of the Holy Spirit. That's the mystery of the Trinity, honestly, that they all kind of demur to one another. And Jesus clearly is following the lead of the Father and the Spirit. How easy is it for you and me to believe that we can be altogether self-sufficient? That we have everything we need apart from God. And the truth is we don't. No, we have everything we need in him. And the Apostle Peter reminds us in 2 Peter 1, his divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. See, the implication here is that if we don't have him, we don't have what we need. And so today, really what I want you to take away from this is the crucial importance of the stripping away of all of the things in our lives that have the potential to numb us to the reality that we need God all of the time, in every moment, and in every season. Well, how does this play out practically, specifically during this Lenten season? Well, traditionally, the Orthodox and the Roman Catholic tradition, there's a focus on three things. I find this so interesting. Prayer, obviously, fasting, because Jesus fasted in the desert, and almsgiving, giving to the poor. And all three of these things, now this is obviously not a hard and fast rule, but all of these things, as I was thinking about them, require us to give something of ourselves. And the purpose behind it is to come to grips with our limitations and all of our attachments and ultimately our sins so that we can prepare ourselves for the coming of Jesus. Don't you want to prepare yourself for the coming of Jesus? Come on. So in a way, we are choosing during this season, and you know what? You don't have to choose in. I'm going to ask you to choose in. But the idea and the practice of observing Lent is to choosing in to limiting ourselves like being in the desert so that we can prepare our minds and our hearts and our spirits for the coming of Jesus. The discipline of Lent is to choose in to what God has for us in the desert. Now, I mentioned before, some of you are already in the desert. You don't need to, like, not eat meat on Fridays or stop drinking or stop eating chocolate or whatever. You are in the desert because life has been difficult. So I'm not saying you need to purposely go into more of the desert. And having been thrust into those desert seasons many times throughout my life, I want to say that I know that that's a hard place, but I believe, now hear me now, I believe that God has something even for you in that place. If you find yourself in a desert season of life, God is speaking. Pay attention. Because I'm convinced that some of the most important formational lessons that God wants to teach us and impart to us and form us into happen in those places of desert, of wilderness. And so if you're in that place, what are you learning about God and about yourself? And for the rest of us, what if we actually gave something up for this season? Right, I'm gonna push you a little bit. What are the things that you spend an exorbitant amount of time doing? You know, I know for many of us it's this, right? Addicted to the reels, right? Addicted to the Insta or whatever. I deleted a couple things. In fact, I think Sharon was the one that asked me earlier in the week, why did you get up for Lent? I'm sorry. You're much sweeter than that imitation of you. I don't think she... Isn't it great that she can laugh at that? And I said I deleted some things off my phone. And I intend to do some more. Because listen, I don't want to ever stand up in front of you and not let the things that I'm saying flow through me and things that I'm asking you to do, I'm going to do those things myself. But there are so many things. Friends, we live in a crazy era where everything's at our fingertips. We live in one of the wealthiest countries in the world. We live in a constant state of distraction. And I'm just putting myself in there. All of those things. What if we said for the next 40 days that we are going to give some significant things up? Maybe they're not significant, but things that take up a crazy amount of our time so that we can make more room for God. Amen. What if we said no to some things so that we can say yes to Him? And that's the challenge. And I can't tell you what that's going to be. For some of you, maybe that's fasting. For some of you, maybe that's just limiting your screen time. Listen, that there are devices now that they say, you know, they've programmed it into the operating system where you can limit your screen time. Maybe you turn that on and put the phone down or the laptop down or the iPad down or whatever it is. What if you and me, spent more time preparing our hearts for Jesus, intentionally going into that desert space? You know, how easy is it, you know, when we're just sitting there, and we all do it, right? I mean, none of you have a flip phone that I can tell. I don't think any of you have a flip phone. Oh, I got one flip phone back there. But what do you do when you're sitting there, you're just like, you know, instead of like engaging in conversation with another person, you're just flipping around and you're out there in the interwebs and Jesus is saying, hey, I am speaking to you. Are you listening? And so will you join me on this journey into the desert? An intentional, purposeful walk into the desert so that we know that we are fully reliant on Jesus Himself. And maybe we just need to pray the Jesus prayer, Lord Jesus, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Amen. I want to challenge you over this next month and change as we lead up to Easter. Would you put some things down so that you could put more of Jesus up? Amen.